Hi, friends. Before I start this episode of First Cup, I want to help you with your Christmas gift shopping plans. Do you have someone special on your list who is hard to shop for? Or are they interested in unique, one-of-a-kind gifts? Then Wishing Stars Native Creations is your answer. My dear friend Chris Mayer has been making Native American jewelry for several years and is ready to help you give that special someone in your life a one-of-a-kind gift. Just go to www.facebook.com/wishingstarsnativecreations. That's facebook.com/wishingstarsnativecreations. It's all one word. Wishing Stars Native Creations. Go there today and find out how Chris can help you. She accepts several forms of payment, including money orders and PayPal.
Now, we all have dogs. Have you ever dressed your dog up?
I honestly have not.
Well, you got a big dog. That's probably why.
She's larger.
Yeah. Mark has a little wiener. Have you ever dressed the wiener up?
Yeah, I do. He's,
What are you doing?
He's, actually, I had a bug there for a second.
I thought something happened.
What have you dressed him in, Mark? Come on, be honest.
Mark?
Long Johns?
No, really?
Yeah. So
that's adorable. You'd win.
That's the most beautiful thing I ever heard.
Well, have you heard about this, friends, in the news? The Washington Times has reportedly dropped the weekly column written by Kentucky Senator Rand Paul. Now, Senator Paul is trying to find a quote on Wikipedia to express how he feels. Good morning, my friends. Today is Friday, November 9th. Let's try that again. It's Friday, November 8th, 2013, and you know what that means. Joe can't read a calendar. It also means it's time for your first cup.
To save his life, call his wife and nothing to say, but what a day, how's your boy been? Nothing to do, it's up to you. I've got nothing to say, but it's okay.
Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Going to work, don't wanna go, feeling low down. Heading for home, you start to roam, then you're in town. Everybody knows there's nothing doing. Everything is closed, it's like a ruin. Everyone you see is half asleep, and you're on your own, you're in the street. After a while, you start to smile, now you feel cool. Then you decide to take a walk by the old school. Nothing has changed, it's still the same. I've got nothing to say, but it's okay.
Good morning.
Good morning, my friends. Welcome to Studio 27. It is the 8th day of November, 2013. Not to be confused with the 9th day of November, which happens to be tomorrow. But of course, if you're listening to us in podcast form, it is long since past November 8th or 9th, I'm sure, by now. I had a Ron Burgundy moment there. I'll read whatever is written in front of me. And the sad part is, I wrote that. That's what I get for putting my show prep together while I'm still halfway asleep. But I'm halfway awake now, so I guess that's par for the course. Welcome to First Cup, and for the next couple of hours, I hope to keep you entertained with the latest in news, weather information. Oh, no weather today, I'm sorry. I forgot about that. No weather today, due to a lack of interest. No weather today due to technical issues there. I'm not sure what happened, but we won't talk about that. Also have what's trending, popular tweets of the day, the song of the day, the Friday funnies, plus a whole lot more, so hope you'll stick around, and I hope to make it worth your while. I'll get to what's on my mind on my Bruce Williams Soapbox segment in just a few minutes, but first things first, wish to remind you that you can send me your emails, comments via email to GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. That's GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. Whether they be likes or dislikes about the program, as well as things you'd like to hear or don't wish to hear. And you can also submit Song of the Day requests, dedications, things of that nature, again, to GunthersHouseOfFriends@gmail.com. And you can also send me your messages via Skype to this account name. Are you ready? It's G800-486-8437. That's the letter G, 800-486-8437. I would have done just a straight number, but Skype won't allow that unless you want to buy a telephone number, and I didn't want to do that just yet. Okay, G800-486-8437. Also, follow me on the old Twitter at jhafner99. That's the letter J. My last name spelled H-A-F-F-N-E-R and the number 99. jhafner99. And also, you can check out my website via your PC, your Mac, your Linux, or tablet computer by going to www.tinyurl.com/Gunther's House, or on your smartphone, whether it's an Android, iOS, or Windows phone, do so by going to tinyurl.com/Gunther Mobile. Plus, you can listen to old episodes of First Cup, along with the previous episode of Joe's Retro Radio. Incidentally, I'll have episode number 2 of Retro Radio coming up this Sunday evening at 6, right here on the network, featuring USO radio tours of days gone past. Anyway, you can check out old programs by downloading the Stitcher app, available at the bottom of the opening page of my website, or going to Stitcher.com, looking up Gunther's House of Friends, and or go to Spreaker.com, be heard, and also look up Gunther's House of Friends that way. Okay? Just a couple of convenient ways to listen to some of my old programs. Alrighty, now then, let's see here. What's on my mind for today, you ask? Of course, earlier this morning, the jobs report came out. And at first glance, this morning's jobs report seems surprisingly upbeat, which is causing concern on Wall Street. And I'll explain why. Traders fear it will cause the Fed to curtail its $85 billion per month bond buying and encourage workers to ask for raises. Which I can't say as I blame a lot of workers asking for a raise, because in this economy, you never know how long your job is going to last, and yours truly is in that category. You know, it's something we all worry about from time to time. But if you look more closely at the jobs numbers, and the news is far from good, the percentage of Americans working or looking for work is at a new 35-year low. Now, to put that in perspective, 35 years ago was 1978. Roughly about the heart of the Jimmy Carter administration, okay? That was before many wives and mothers began entering the workforce in large numbers to prop up family incomes, being dragged down by declining male wages. Now, by the way, the employer survey wasn't distorted by the shutdown last month. The Bureau of Labor Statistics counted furloughed workers as employed because they were ultimately paid for their time off. So they aren't considered part of this downturn, okay? Federal government jobs, by the way, fell only 12,000 last month. So out of 800,000 plus workers, that's, you know, it's not great, but it could have been a lot worse. Some other things on my mind today. One other big thing, kind of a follow-up to what I was talking about on prayer yesterday. And this is a story that comes from the land of 1,000 lakes, Minnesota. Or is it 10,000 lakes, isn't it? Well, anyway, a public school bus driver in Minnesota has been fired after repeatedly forcing his captive audience of school bus children to listen to his Christian prayers. And I imagine some of you out there are going, well, what's wrong with that? Well, for one thing, if it were another religion, say Judaism or Islam or Hinduism or Buddhism or something like that, especially if it were Islam in this country, you would hear no end to the protest. There'd be boycotts and everything else going on. I don't know how you boycott a school bus, but you know what I mean. Well, it seems that 49-year-old George Nathaniel, a bus driver for the Burnsville School District, had already been reassigned and given a warning due to his repeated praying, but that didn't stop him from preaching to the school children on his bus every day. Nathaniel described his daily routine as, quote, we start out with a song, then each person will pray if they want to pray. If they don't want to pray, they don't have to pray. Then I will pray and ask them if they want to join me in prayer. Just give them something constructive and positive to go to school with, unquote. After first receiving complaints from the district about the prayers, the bus company, Durham School Services, gave Nathaniel a warning and assigned him two new bus routes serving the Edward D. Neal Elementary School and Metcalf Junior High School, respectively, in Burnsville. However, when Mr. Nathaniel returned to or continued to lead prayers on his new routes, Durham sent him a separation letter on October 30th saying, quote, there have been more complaints of religious material on the bus as well as other complaints regarding performance. In accordance with the previous final written warning you received, your employment is hereby terminated, unquote. Now, ACLU legal director Teresa Nelson said Nathaniel was in violation of the First Amendment by praying. The school bus is a captive audience. When he is driving, the bus is acting like a school official, and he does not have the right to promote religion or proselytize in that context. Okay, unquote. And I agree with ACLU, and I agree with the decision by the school bus company. My thought is, if you want to be a preacher, you join a church and go through those ranks. Or, say, for example, if you want to become a Methodist preacher, you know, you have to go through conference, and you have to go through some various training. Or if you want to start your own church, that's fine. I don't have a problem with that. But you don't do it on the public dole. And you don't do it to kids, because I'm sure there are some atheists in that group. And there were probably some other religious denominations, too. It's probably predominantly Lutheran. That's a good part of Minnesota's population, isn't it? At least some of it, according to Garrison Keillor. So this guy was clearly in violation, and I don't support his feel his need to pray in that manner. Well, I know I want to hear arguments from Christians go, well, this country is going downhill since we don't allow, since we quit allowing prayer in public schools. You know, if that was what was truly holding us together, don't you think that the Constitution would have been rewritten to allow it? You know, just because it was allowed for over a century and a half without much scrutiny doesn't mean that it was the right thing to do. Now, I've been reading a book on presidential history in this country, and the Founding Fathers would have a conniption fit if they knew that our money was now printed with the words, "In God We Trust," because, as I have said on this program, that is a public endorsement of a particular religious deity, namely of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And regardless of where you stand, I am right. Okay? To me, there is no debate on this. And I think "In God We Trust" must be removed from our money. Because if we trust God so much, then why are we always trying to cater to his ego? And it goes back to the days of when the only way you knew how to get rid of a commie was to have him say, does he believe?